I am very pleased to be here. Thank you again to AGI for including the state of Colorado in this webinar. And we also very much appreciate everybody joining today. I look forward to having a little bit of a discussion after our presentation. I'm going to talk a little bit about some of our efforts around building risk and measuring resilience after the 2013 floods, as well as some record wildfires that we had in 2012 and 2013. That builds a little bit on the technical information we heard from Marie and tries to incorporate some of the engagement work that Marie has been doing in South Carolina. So we'll just jump right into it. To let folks know a little bit about our office, we had record floods in 2013, in September of 2013, here in Colorado. And shortly after the floods, Governor Hickenlooper determined that he wanted to have a dedicated recovery team within the governor's office, whose mission was to partner closely with our state partners across various different departments to work with our federal agencies and support our local communities, really in focusing on keeping a sense of urgency over the long run, building transparency with our recovery partners and with the public especially, and then really thinking about how we can rebuild in such a way that we incorporate resilience and hopefully avoid the same level of losses the next time it rains like it did in 2013 or the next time we have a wildfire like we did in 2012. It's always good to give ourselves a reminder, especially when we're working with 30 different funding programs in many different communities and a lot of rules and regulations, to remind ourselves what the work is about. And really, at the end of the day, it's about people. It's about the folks who had to be evacuated, who had their homes and businesses impacted, and who are still working to recover today. And that really helps us to keep a strong sense of what it is that we need to accomplish and keep that unity and, again, that sense of urgency around the recovery process. Since I know we have folks from around the country on the webinar, I also briefly want to give a little Colorado context. Our state, which I believe is the eighth biggest state in the country, is very geographically, economically, and culturally diverse. We have areas of steep terrain, those iconic Rockies that everybody see, as well as plains communities, agricultural communities, and everything in between. I mentioned we're a big state, about 104,000 square miles. But then in the context of land use, of disaster recovery, of governance in general, we are a home rule state where our local communities have a lot of control around those decisions that directly impact their communities. So again, land use, some fiscal and other authorities, where the state's role in a lot of cases is to provide that support to communities as opposed to regulate. I also want to mention that we do have a strong mitigation track record in Colorado. We went for a period of time without a lot of major disasters, but our communities during that time remained busy with projects either funded locally with state support or applying for grants through agencies such as the Federal Emergency Management Agency to reduce their risk. In fact, some of those projects did get tested during our record wildfires and floods in 2012 and 2013. This just gives a little bit of a snapshot. It is not all encompassing of the disasters that we've had in Colorado. We had the 1965 floods, which were originally or previous to 2013 were the largest disaster in state history in terms of the amount of damages and the dollar value of those damages. We also had in 1976 the Big Thompson flood, where tragically 145 lives were lost between Estes Park and Loveland, near the Front Range but up towards the mountains. That was a flood where we found out about our steep canyons, our steep terrain, and what that means for very flashy floods, if you will. In 2002, we had record droughts and wildfires. The Hayman Fire, which is perhaps the best known of that year, burned 137,000 acres, but we had large wildfires throughout the state. And then again in 2012 and 2013, 2015, we had record wildfires that destroyed 1,100 homes and caused $1.2 billion in insurance claims. And then, as I've mentioned, in 2013, we had 24 counties impacted by flooding. We estimate about $3.9 billion in damages, and again, 10 lives lost. This next slide really speaks for itself. It just gives you an overview of the disasters that we've had in the last 3 to 4 years. And the purpose of the slide is, again, to remind us what our work is about, but also to lay the groundwork for why we are thinking about risk assessment and resilience for the long term. So I will not go through all these numbers one by one, but the real number that matters here is that thousands and thousands of people's lives were changed forever by our disasters that we had. So I would now like to shift into some discussion about our statewide resiliency efforts. And to lay that groundwork, I'll talk about several of the factors that we considered when we embarked on a year and a half long journey to develop our Colorado resiliency framework. We have really three converging factors at the same time. First, we know that we have risks from disasters based on what we've seen and what I already highlighted a little bit earlier. And we know that those disasters will continue into the future. We will have wildfires. We have a highly variable climate, which means that we will likely have floods again as well. Secondly, though, Colorado is growing, and it's growing fast. We project through our demography office at the Colorado Department of Local Affairs that Colorado is going to grow by approximately 50% in the next 25 years or so, going up from 5 million people at the 2010 census up to 7.7 million people by 2040. That is a lot of growth, and that is a lot of potential growth, both in safe areas, but also in the wildland-urban interface that might increase impervious surfaces where we'll see more stormwater flooding if we don't plan appropriately. And the third factor is that we are observing and seeing trends and changes. We're seeing that droughts may become more frequent. We are seeing that temperatures may increase, which really adds to that already existing level of variability that we have. And taking that all together, thinking about resilience in both the context of the shocks or the floods and the fires and the underlying stresses, affordable housing, economic diversity, climate conditions, things like that, we do want to think about and really act on resilience. That leads us to, in 2014, our office, working in partnership with 27 different agencies, began the journey of developing the Colorado Resiliency Framework. It was a process where we both learned and trained ourselves about what resilience means and really thinking deliberatively about how we define it so we had a clear mission, but also planning for action and creating a call for action for our communities. You see on the screen right now the definition of resiliency that we came up with. I always point to my favorite word in there. Resilience, in a lot of ways, is about trying to preserve and enhance our way of life, knowing that there are uncertainties like disasters, changing conditions, and rapid growth. And we want to set our communities up to thrive amidst those changing conditions or challenges. As I mentioned, and you can find our resiliency framework at coloradounited.com, but our framework is integrated and interdisciplinary. We had a lot of tremendous support from our federal partners from across various different departments, as well as departments across state government. We also got input from local partners, a peer review panel, and others. But when we developed the framework, we developed it to think about resilience in, again, an integrated and interdisciplinary way. And therefore, we created teams of sectors, and we identified six different sectors that really dug into what are the shocks and stresses impacting their sectors, but also how do they integrate across our various different sectors. So our infrastructure folks were thinking about how they relate to housing or watersheds and natural resources. Our community group thinking about land use planning and growth and emergency management were thinking about social vulnerability or economic diversity. And really the value of our framework was bringing all of those different sectors together. The governor adopted the Colorado Resiliency Framework in May of 2015, and since then we have moved into implementation mode across our Colorado Resiliency Working Group, or our state leadership team. We have really seen our efforts break into three priority areas for action. The first is recognizing that resilience is a relatively new discipline, and we want to both build capacity, but really empower a culture of resilience at the federal, state, local, non-government level. So one of our key initiatives there is we developed our Colorado Resiliency Resource Center. You can find that at coresiliency.com, but really diving into how we can understand, plan for, and act on resilience, and begin to build that discipline at all levels, as I mentioned. The second piece is we really need to understand what our risk is to inform the actions and the investments that we've made. And so collecting and analyzing and providing data and information about our risk has been a really critical aspect that I'll dive into in just a minute here. And then the third piece of that is how do we take our culture and how do we take our awareness of risk and start to integrate that into our capital investments in a more holistic way. And we've made great strides with our flood recovery process. You see an example on the screen of our design of our roadways next to our rivers in steep mountain canyons, and how can we strengthen the roadway at the same time as giving the river more room to meander, improving water quality, and protecting both infrastructure and private property. And so we need to think about the whole system. I wanted to provide just an overview specifically of a few of our efforts to enhance our risk information and then our decision-making tools that go and integrate that risk information. The first was a hydrology effort that was conducted by our Colorado Water Conservation Board there within the Department of Natural Resources and our Colorado Department of Transportation. And immediately after the floods, they recognized that this event was of a size and magnitude that we had not seen in quite some time. And likewise, the data that was available to help us understand what our risk was, but also to inform reconstruction activities, was out of date. So they worked together. You see on here a number of different watersheds where they completely updated the hydrology that involved collecting rainfall intensity data, looking at stream gauges, post-flood high water marks, also collecting LIDAR. And together they were able, over about a year to year and a half period, completely update the hydrology. But they went a step further and partnered with FEMA to get that signed off on as best available data. And what that means is we were able to use this updated hydrology as opposed to pre-existing flood insurance studies to inform the design and engineering for our reconstruction activities. And for our communities, this was a really important tool to have to ensure that we're building back to a standard that is informed by our most current data around risk. The hydrology is also informing our floodplain remapping efforts, as well as risk education and regulation efforts at the local and the state level. Building on top of that, we also, across our state agencies, partnered to understand what our needs for floodplain mapping information were. And after that effort, the state legislature in 2015 authorized a three-year program under Senate Bill 15245 to remap our flood-impacted watersheds, basically from top to bottom of those flood-impacted watersheds in northern Colorado out to the Nebraska line. That included incorporating the new hydrology, doing field surveys, again collecting LIDAR where needed, and developing new floodplain boundaries. The legislation also authorized us to modernize 28 counties where they still had paper floodplain maps from the 1970s. And so this was a recognition that this was not just about our flood-impacted watersheds, but the entire state. The bill also authorized the development of debris flow mapping in high-risk, high-consequence areas by our Colorado Geologic Survey, as well as developing a methodology and pilot mapping for erosion zones. And one of the big things that we saw with the Colorado floods was, as it says on the slide, the rivers didn't just flow downhill, but they flowed side to side. Sometimes they burst out of their banks and damaged areas where folks did not have information they were in the floodplain, but they were certainly in an area susceptible to erosion. And so understanding that threat in conjunction with flooding was very, very important for our recovery. So a third piece, building on our hydrology and then developing maps to better understand our risk, our community sector of our Colorado Resiliency Working Group, led by the Colorado Department of Local Affairs, developed a guide that they call Planning for Hazards, and you can go to planningforhazards.com to find out more about that. But it is a very comprehensive guide that provides guidance on developing hazard identification and risk assessments. It then identifies, analyzes, and goes over a flexible set of land use tools to enhance mitigation. And I'll reiterate that Colorado is a home rule state. So taking this approach of providing the tools that communities can use in their context was an important part of this effort. It has some model code language as well. So if a community wants to integrate stream buffers or setback models into their policies, there is language to help them do that included in the guide. So while it was developed to be specific to Colorado, our hope is that it can be applicable and helpful for communities around the country. And finally, before I turn it back over to Ben, I just wanted to talk for a brief moment about local and public engagement. In all of these efforts, both informing but also getting input from the public and from our local communities was absolutely critical. So as a part of the Colorado Resiliency Framework, we conducted focus groups in communities around the state, a number of interviews, surveys, but most importantly, we actually had a peer review process where we brought in folks who weren't necessarily part of developing the framework, but they read all the way through that, provided a tremendous amount of input, and we actually were able to make a lot of positive changes there. We also collected Resiliency Heroes nominations, which were great to read and see some inspiring stories from around the state. With the hydrology, the CWCB and Colorado Department of Transportation team met with individual communities. They reviewed the draft results, gathered input on the methodology and the data, and were able to refine and make sure that those communities were comfortable with, but more importantly, able to use that information. The floodplain mapping effort is still underway. There's a lot of engagement with local communities, but also with flood risk review meetings within individual impacted communities so that we have that participation and solicitation of input throughout the process. Likewise, with the Planning for Hazards, they formed a team, an advisory committee that was a part of the entire development process and is still working together. That includes federal, state, local, and non-advisory or non-government members, as well as our University of Colorado at Denver. So with that, Ben, I will turn it back over to you for the question and answer, and I really appreciate, again, you including the state of Colorado on this webinar.